Welcome to The New Chemist. We're glad you're listening. Feel free to download this podcast on Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and other platforms. On The New Chemist, we discuss chemistry, which simply put is a science of change, as well as careers, community research, and COVID-19. We're happy you're tuning in. My guest today is Omar Sharafali, a colleague of mine from Georgia Tech. Thanks for joining me today. It is so good to hear from you. Just briefly, I'll inform my audience about you. Omar Sharafali has both bachelor's and master's degrees from Georgia Tech in the field of computer science. He graduated with a bachelor's degree in computer science with highest honors and a master's degree specifically in machine learning. He has served as a graduate research assistant and an undergraduate artificial intelligence researcher. He is also multilingual, speaking English, Gujarati, Hindi, and Urdu. An accomplished and up-and-coming computer scientist, he is on a good path to making a positive difference in the world. Please welcome Omar Sharafali.
Well, Omar, thanks for joining me today. It's good to have you on.
Hey, thanks for having me, David.
Wow. So how have you been, Omar? How have things been since the last time I saw you and you were colleagues and you lived right down the hall from me? And what was it, Montauk Hall?
Yeah, that was freshman year of college, man. It's been a long time.
Yeah, it's been 10 years.
Yeah, things have definitely changed, man. So, we were living on the pre-health floor at that time, right?
Yes, we were.
So I remember when I was a freshman, what I wanted to do was computer science with pre-health. That's why I was living on the pre-health floor with you guys. I was the only computer science major, if you remember.
Yeah.
So, I mean, after finishing school and during school, I didn't really think there was like a good combination of the two, like computer science and health medicine type fields. Mm-hmm. But yeah, with my new job that I just started, like, I'm happy I finally found that mix because it took me a while, right? Like, so it's been 7 years since freshman year. I didn't find any type of role like that, honestly. So, I just started this January. So 6 years from freshman year, when I first had that original vision in my head, it finally
actualized,
manifested. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good one. Yeah. Certain flames don't die usually. So getting started, what have been your longstanding interests in the field of computer science? It seems like you hinted at them through the period.
Yeah. I mean, ever since I was a kid, like I've always just been fascinated with like computers. Just like there's just so much you can do on a computer, whether it's like, you know, playing video games, writing software, just browsing the internet. Like it's just like a whole wealth of information, right? So. Mm-hmm. I think for me, like, I just got interested at a young age. Like, I used to, like, you know how it is now today where you see, like, kids always on their phone? Well, like, I guess I was, like, one of those first types of kids. But it was, like, you know, technology obviously wasn't that to the extent it is at now when I was here. But I definitely had some influence, right? Like, I had a laptop as, like, an early teenager.
Okay.
You know, so I used to play a lot of video games on it. Like, I even got into, like, writing, like, scripts for video games and all that. So I got into like that whole like concept early, and I didn't even know what I was doing at that time. Like when I was at that age, it was just like I was just messing around, basically, like just having fun, right? And then
that's good.
You know, as I got older, I was coming around for like end of high school, college time, and like I didn't really know computer science was a field, but like as I was introduced to it, I was like, oh, okay, like this is basically like what I've always been interested in, like as a field, right? So after getting introduced to that concept, like I was able to like kind of channel my energy towards it. And I think like a lot of people that I've talked to, like who've started computer science late in their lives, it's been like, oh, like I'm late to it because I just didn't really know about it. So I think there's like a huge advantage for people to like learn it early or like be exposed to it earlier, just so it's like in their mind that this is like a career path and all that. So
yeah, you bring up a very interesting concept and something that I value highly, the concept or the principle of exposure. You know, I don't think, you know, I honestly think that sometimes exposure could carry as much weight as expiration. And what I mean by that is exposing someone to like say, for example, chemistry is my field, so exposing someone to like kinetics, fundamental kinetic principles or rate laws or whatever the case may be, exposing them to that early so that they get to see where their interest lies. I think that could be as beneficial as them sitting down and studying it as well. Depending on who's the person exposing them to the material, how well they're understanding it. So how do you maintain view of the bigger picture in your career and in your life in general?
I mean, I think for me, it really just starts as like, you got to understand what you want out of your career and your profession and all that. And like, so for me, like I was saying, like I was always interested in medicine, but like, why was I interested in medicine? Well, I think like my interest really came with like, I wanted to help people or like make a positive impact on the world. Right.
Mm-hmm.
So, like if you're working on software, that's like, you know, whatever, like related to anything, there's a lot of times where you're working on software that might not be relevant to the world, like making a positive impact in the world, like making a difference in people's lives, essentially. Right. So there's some fields where you could like apply computer science to. So I think for me, like my big picture was that like, okay, well, what do I want to do with my life and career? Mm-hmm. And like, that's like make a positive impact in the world and like have like, you know, my stamp on like whatever my career does. Right. So I think that's like my biggest motivator. Like even today, like I still think about that, like what can I do in terms of my career to like get there? Like ideally after I finish my career, I made a positive impact, you know, through my work and all of that. So I think keeping that as your big picture and like what you really want, some people's big pictures are different, right? Like some people just want to make money. Some people just, you know, want status. Some people like have a drive to make a positive impact in the world. Right. So like understanding that first and foremost is really like crucial to understanding the big picture. And for me, it was like, I wanted to make a positive impact. So, you know, I always try to tailor like all my decisions and career paths down that ultimate goal.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah, man. And it's interesting, like you said, you from in the previous question, you mentioned how you were exposed to like fundamental computer science principles through video games. I've heard similar sentiments from one of the professors at Georgia Tech, and he talked about the Atari. I'm not sure the games console. Yeah, the Atari game console, and how he was introduced to that by one of his relatives, and he went about the same path in which he was making modifications of the game, so fundamental computer science principles. So how have you been adaptive and creative in the field of science, in your field of computer science to be exact?
Yeah.
Where do you think you are carving out a niche or complementing to some authentic footprint that you leave?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, so computer science itself is a broad field in general. Like computer science, really, like when people ask me like, oh, like I want to do this, like I want to do that with computer science, I'm like, dude, like if you want, you can do whatever you want with computer science, right? Like you can say like, I want to do computer science and I want to work on like some specialty robotics. I want to do this, I want to do that, right? For me, I've been trying to distinguish myself in the sense that like I did my master's also at GT, as you know, and I specialize in artificial intelligence and machine learning, and machine learning is a subfield of artificial intelligence, right? So like already through there, like I've started to specialize and create my niche. And for me, the reason why I decided to go down like something like that was, again, like what can I learn to distinguish myself from others, but also like make a positive impact in the world, right? So like you see like so many use cases of AI in any field, but specifically like for me, like at my current job, I work at a precision medicine company, and that means that the company basically is built on top of like AI and uses all our data to make like smart decisions about like healthcare and medicine and treating people, improving people's qualities of life. So I think like for me, I've been trying to distinguish myself as, okay, like, yes, I know computer science, but even more specifically, like I know AI concepts as well, and I know how to apply them. Right. So like you can really go into whatever field, but even more specifically, like I want to take that one step further where it's like, okay, not only do I have a specialty in AI, like I want to be to a one point where one day I'm like, okay, I have a specialty in AI specifically related to medicine and like carve that out as my niche, right? So like later in my career, I can get to a point where it's like, okay, you know, instead of being more of the person who's like actually on the ground, essentially like doing the hard work and all that, like more as somebody with like a vision and like guiding projects and things like that with the vision, right? So I think like that's kind of where I see my career going down, or how I want my career to go moving forward. So
do you see that nesting more on requiring more training, like a PhD?
I thought about it. Honestly, I was actually like this close to doing my PhD. And I think for me, it was the biggest thing that I had with against doing my PhD was the speed at which academia moves is a bit slower than industry. Like I think that's a pretty well-known like fact as well. Like you've seen
Anand Tabaki.
Yeah, you've seen people like Elon Musk even come out and say that, and other like people who, that's just by putting the pressure on industry. I think actually I was watching an interview of Sundar Pichai, the CEO of Google. He was saying the same thing. He was saying how Google's mission is to kind of like set the precedent for new technologies because they're the fastest, they're able to take it to market faster than like academia and all of that, right? Because being a big company, they can hire like people with PhDs and all that, and even partner with research, but they're the ones actually putting it in people's hands, right? So I think for me, that was like one of the bigger reasons too, where it's like, okay, well, I want to make an impact faster, sooner, you know? But it's hard. I mean, you have to grow your career first before you can kind of like start thinking about those types of ideas, right? So, you know, I've only been working for about 3 years now. So, which is like good. I'm getting a lot of exposure to even the field as a whole, but it takes a while for you to get to that point where it's like, okay, like you're actually making moves, right? So,
yeah.
I think that was a big decision.
Yeah. So interesting that you said that, because, you know, in terms of industry, many academic labs are funded by different companies. So that's very true. Like Novartis and Pfizer, or whatever the case may be. Yeah, they are funded by those pharmaceutical companies are funded by those large industries.
Yeah,
makes sense. It makes a lot of sense. So, you studied at Georgia Tech. You worked with different companies. How have you sort of found the right environment for you to thrive scientifically and intellectually?
Yeah.
Would you say found that environment, Omar?
Yeah, I mean, so for me, like my first job coming out of college, like I was doing artificial intelligence work at Capital One, a finance company, right? And so initially, like I was happy with the work that I was doing, but for me, like going back to what I was saying earlier, I have a deeper motivation, right? So I think when I switched companies, now working at Tempus, it's a precision medicine company, and it's technically still a startup, right? So that fast-paced environment where you're working on new things and going fast, I feel like has been a better environment for me so far. I've only been here for about 6 months, but I'm really liking that because like it's fast-paced and I feel like every day I'm doing something, it's like taking us one step closer toward like my ultimate like goal, right? Which is like improving people's lives and, you know, making a positive impact. So I think it depends, right? Like some people wouldn't want to work at a startup. Some people would probably prefer like a lax work environment and all that. And oftentimes like startups are on the edge of like new technologies and like fast-paced environments and like typically even applying like the newest science too, right? So like then that's kind of how they become successful, right? Like somebody comes up with somebody discovers something, they want to apply it and they make a startup and boom, 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 you're starting to go, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think so far I'm definitely enjoying a fast-paced environment. And I really like that. Like I feel like I'm making contributions on a daily basis.
Okay, that's good. So several things I want to ask about that. My question is, how do you manage working in a fast-paced environment? That's a very practical question. Because I think a number of people in graduate programs, when you adjust from undergrad to graduate school, the pace of pickup, I think, so far.
Yeah.
So for most people, the pickup and my cost of your price increases.
Yeah.
So, how are you managing that?
Especially I think
COVID.
Yeah. I think first and foremost, you have to kind of like understand what you're getting yourself into, right? Like,
yeah.
If you realize, you have to first understand, like, oh, are you capable, or is this even, forget capable, is this even something that you want, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I was actually at my last job, I was desiring something faster, right? So I was like, okay, I want something faster. So I think for me, I came in with the expectation knowing that, like, hey, I might have to work more hours than I was working at my last job. So you have to like really manage your expectations in that sense. But I think sometimes you do get, it is tough, right? Like some days you're like working like late into the evening and mm-hmm. and then you're like, man, like this is so tough. Like I'm mentally drained and all that. So
yeah, I've been there.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, realizing that like it's really common in academia too, right? Like I did my master's. I saw the same thing happening for a lot of people. But I just kind of understand like, you have to know that that's something that you're willing to take on if you put yourself in that position too, right? So I think for me, like I was ready for it. I wanted it. And like, so I'm like, it doesn't bother me as much in the sense that like, if I wasn't expecting like a fast paced environment where I would have to work a little bit extra, then I'd probably be like, oh man, I'm so stressed out. Like I can't handle this, all that, right?
Mm-hmm.
You gotta be like mentally ready for it as well.
Yeah, mentally prepare yourself for what you have to go through. And all of those things are hemmed within the narrative of the academic journey, the highs and the lows.
For sure, yeah.
Yeah, they're hemmed in, like, it's almost like a garment.
For sure.
Yeah, but at the same time, how do you maintain balance? I think we are progressing well. How do you maintain balance in your life, given your responsibilities and your accomplishments? I would say you're a very progressive young person, a colleague, and I would say a friend of mine.
Yeah.
You're multilingual. You run your stripes.
Mm-hmm.
You speak Gujarati, Hindu, Urdu. You run your stripes. So how do you maintain balance?
Yeah, I mean, I think like this is probably just like for related to what anyone, like you have to figure out, like you have to have balance in your life just in every regards too, not just like work and school and all of that too, right? Like I'm a big proponent of like keeping balance in multifacets of your life, where it's like,
okay,
for me personally, it's like I like to keep a balance with sports and fitness, work, family, religion. So I think like finding like different things that you realize that you're kind of maybe leaning skewed one way, let's say like you're skewed towards like maybe working too much. Like you need to find those different categories where you can kind of like draw some of that attention to other things and kind of like full balance, essentially, like harmony across these different like aspects of your life. Because I think it's really important too, like at the end of the day, work is work, right? Like you're working, you might have a deeper mission, but at the end of the day, like there's, at least to me, there's more important things than like that mission, where it's like your family is really important, you know, your mm-hmm. mental health is really important.
Oh yeah.
Your physical health is really important too. So if you start to let one of those drift, it actually affects everything else, right? So
mm-hmm.
if you spend too much time on work and you let your physical and mental health drift, then your work is actually going to start getting impacted as well, right? So
mm-hmm.
it's actually been, I feel like it's actually beneficial for you to like not skew, not overweigh on one different part of your life more than the others. I mean that's the constant challenge of life, right? Like
we all struggle
with keeping balance with different things.
Especially
as you know, like going to Georgia Tech, it's tough, man. So we know about that. We have that that bond. We're Georgia Tech grads, so we know that how hard and difficult that was. So
yeah, for me it was a little different. I would say I didn't graduate to Georgia Tech.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
But even so, just going there, getting that exposure, like
yeah. So definitely being there, I would say being there, networking there, of course, it exposes you to different ways to approach problems, and I think that's one of the things that's an indelible impression in my mind. I got in terms of academia and all those other things. But yeah, dude, I've never heard it discussed that way before. Having balance, like compartmentalizing your life and having balance in each one of those compartments. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's interesting. That's definitely an interesting perspective. Because, you know, I've heard different discussions of balance, and that balance is dynamic, and mm-hmm. that balance is not just static sense of perfection, but mm-hmm. the dynamic in which you adjust to all of the different things that are requiring your attention.
For sure.
Requiring just requiring you to address them. So yeah, that's an interesting perspective. Very interesting. I'm probably going to talk that somewhere and look into that afterwards. So Omar, my question to you now is, what would you attribute to your success? What has been complimentary to you being successful?
Yeah, I mean,
outgoing personality, what is it?
Yeah, I mean, well, first in my head, like, I haven't reached success in my head.
Okay, that's very good. That's an honest assessment of yourself.
Yeah, I think that's one of the things that drives and motivates me, right? Like, mm-hmm. I'm not content with where I'm at, right? So, mm-hmm. and many people like are content, like they come out of college, they find a job, they're working, like cool, like they're happy with that, right? For me, like I said, like I set high standards and high life goals for myself, right? So mm-hmm. my definition of success is not short-term success, it's long-term success. And, you know, like that doesn't just extend to like work life, it extends to personal life too, right? Like you success in my definition is like success in work, success in your personal life, and like not only enabling yourself for a good future, enabling your family for a good future and all of that too, right? So mm-hmm. And then yeah, I think constantly like working on yourself and all of that like is something that I try to do. So like I said, I don't feel like I've reached success, but mm-hmm. things that I have done is like just try to be proactive and mm-hmm. Like try to be easygoing in the work environment. And also mm-hmm. like one thing that's really helped me, and it's like kind of specific to my job, is like communication. Mm-hmm. The better communicator you are, like it'll just set you up for success in any environment, I feel like. Mm-hmm. So like specifically in working in software and AI and stuff like that, like communicating, making sure you're like really sharing everything you learn and all of that is like, is something that I've been trying to make an effort to get better at. And I feel like by me getting better at it, it helps me like achieve more at my job too, right? So mm-hmm. I think that's definitely something that like I've been trying to actively work on, mm-hmm. and it's definitely been helping too. So
yeah, dude, I completely agree. And you know, this is my personal opinion, you may feel as if you haven't reached success as a noun, but I think the adjective successful can be used to describe you. So and I agree with the fact that you said success in the long term is more like setting others up and setting yourself up for prosperity and doing well in the future, and also having impact over time, not just in one instance or like over like 2 or 3 years. So I agree with you. So how do you maintain vision and teamwork in your environment? How are you maintaining that, especially during COVID?
Yeah. I mean,
COVID could be isolating sometimes. I think everyone has realized it.
Yeah. I mean, like going back to the point of teamwork and COVID, like I think that was something that a lot of people were hit on. It's hard to have that same like teamwork when you're completely virtual, right? Like, mm-hmm. so I remember like,
you can't high five your friends.
You can't. Yeah. None of that. You know, you can't.
I mean, you can't do that. That's so critical.
You can't roll your chair over and be like, hey, like, what's this, like, can you explain this to me, right? Where it's like now you have to formulate your ideas into words and like make sure those words are actually like clear. Mm-hmm. So like I mean, I guess it kind of relates back to what I was saying earlier, like your communication becomes even more important during times like this, right? For teamwork. And like yeah, I definitely think that COVID's been tough, but people are adjusting. Like mm-hmm. for example, like
a lot of tech companies are now like allowing people to fully remote. And I think people are really liking working fully remote. Also goes back to the idea of balance that we were kind of talking about too, right? People are becoming, having more balanced lives in the sense that like they don't work every hour from 9 to 5. Like they'll maybe take an hour, go for a run, and then work an extra hour later, or like, you know, pick their kids up from school and then make up those time like later in the evening or something like that, right? So I think yeah, definitely like that balance has changed with working from home and COVID and all that, but some people really enjoy that. I mean, I'm still young, like I still want to go into the office and like just like, you know, kind of getting that grind vibe and all that. Like, I don't really have too much responsibilities and family and all that. So, but yeah.
That's fair. So as we conclude, why did you choose computer science as a field to major in? And what advice do you have for those wanting to pursue the field you're currently working in?
Yeah. So like, yeah, computer science, I think I really just chose it because I feel like it's not a specific field such that like, okay, you go into medicine, you're working on medicine for the rest of your life, right? Like for the most part, right? Like that's kind of like how a lot of these different fields are. Like you go into finance, you mostly stay in finance, right? If you go into computer science, you really just learn a way of solving and doing things, right? Like you can do whatever you want with a computer science degree. You could go into finance, you could go into medicine, you could go into video games, like you were saying, go into like anything, right? So I think for me, it was like, okay, well, I have a huge interest in computers already, but I don't really know exactly what I want to go into, like what industry, I guess, like finance, medicine, and all that. I initially, like I said, I wanted to go into medicine, but when I was early on in college, like I didn't really think that was going to work out. Because like, it just wasn't like 6 years ago now, like time flies, like the whole landscape of tech was vastly different even 6 years ago. So I think understanding that, like I chose computer science because like, I really understood that like, oh yeah, I could go a lot of different directions with this. Right. And it's something that that interested me. So that's kind of why I chose it. And then what was the second part of the question that you were saying?
My second part was, what advice do you have for those wanting to pursue the field you're currently working in?
Yeah, I mean, so I think for people who want to go into computer science is like, try it out, like first and foremost, like see how you like it and all that. There's so many like tutorials, like different ways of doing like intros to computer science. Like, for example, I volunteered for an organization called Girls Who Code, right? And basically like the whole point of the organization is to like increase exposure to like young girls to computer science, just so they can like even get the idea in their head, okay, this is what computer science is, maybe I want to go into it, right? So like exposing yourself just to the concept first and foremost is like obviously the best way, kind of like what we were saying earlier. Like you need to really like understand what it is, and like if some people's like some people don't think in the way that would make sense for going to computer science. Like I've met some of my cousins who were like tried going to computer science and they're like, yeah, I just feel like my brain just doesn't like formulate like thoughts and stuff like that, like putting it into code and all that. But a lot of people can like really easily pick it up. So I think trying it out, and there's like a number of different ways to try it out. Like you could, if you're interested in sports, there's something you could do for sports, like just for fun, right? Like you could download some sports data and like try to manipulate that data and like whatever, right? Like you can get exposure that way, or you can follow a tutorial on how to make a game. Like you can, making a game is like, there's software that you could use to easily make it. Like, for example, I know
Jupyter like notebooks.
Yeah. You could do Jupyter notebooks. I know a 13-year-old who made a game.
Wow.
Cause he just got curious. Like he wanted to make a game. He like found out how to do it, he found a tutorial and he made a game, right? And now he wants to go into computer science, right?
Yeah. Swirl.
Huh?
Swirl for R.
Yeah. There's so many different things. Like a lot of people are getting exposed to it in grad school for a variety of different things, because
you need it for a lot of different fields as well, right? So
it gives you more prowess.
Yeah, more exactly. So I think it's more of like, it's a tool that anyone could really use in any field. Like, mm-hmm. whether even forget, like, okay, maybe you don't want to like go specialize in it. You don't want that to be your major. But you could still benefit from having that knowledge. Like, in fact, like, I know a number of people, number of my friends who are at engineers, and they're like, oh yeah, like when I was interviewing, they asked me if I knew like how to code or anything like that, right? So mm-hmm. Just like try it out. At the worst, like you can say that, okay, yeah, I kind of know how to code. Like I went through a tutorial or something like that. So I think that's my advice. And then there's also a lot of subfields for computer science. Like what I was mentioning earlier, if you're interested in sports, like you could do some data science. You could do data analytics. Like that's not like, that's a specific field of computer science that honestly today is pretty easy to get into. Like you have a programming language called Python, super easy to use.
Very powerful.
Like I use it every day at my work. That's our main programming language. And like, that's also the main programming language that a lot of people first learn, right? So I think that could give confidence to people hearing like, okay, like a professional like me uses Python every day at their job. And it's also the easiest one to learn, right? So I think that today and tomorrow and next week, it's only going to get easier and easier to learn how to code and like get exposed to it. So
Yeah, I agree. So what is the most beneficial advice you have received as we conclude? What is the most beneficial advice you have received if you had to like sum it down to like two or three statements?
Yeah. Oh, that's a tough one, man.
Yeah. Whew. I'm sure you're up to it.
Yeah. Best advice that I've ever received.
Mm-hmm.
I think.
Oh, what resonates with you more? What replays in your mind? You go through challenging times.
Yeah, I'm thinking about a few things. Yeah, I'm thinking about a few things, but I think for me, some of the best advice that I've received, and like, it's, I don't want to be repetitive, but it's like figuring out your long-term vision. Like, I think like early on, like what I was saying earlier, I realized that I wanted to like make my long-term vision be like, okay, I want to have a positive impact on the world, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think really figuring that out, a lot of people don't know that. Like I have so many cousins who are like just trying to get into college or like just in that phase, and I'll be like, okay, so what do you want to, like, what do you plan on like majoring in or all that? And a lot of them are like, yeah, I don't know. And then I'll be like, okay, well, like, what do you want to do? Like, what's your, like, what do you want to do with your career? Like, what's your final outcome? So like always having the big picture, like in your head is like super beneficial for you. Like some people's big picture might just be like, hey, I want to save up a lot of money and retire. Like, okay, that's your big picture. Well, like really figure out if that's what you want. Right. Mm-hmm. So I think really figuring out what you want from your like career and even more deeper than that, like your life. I think that's definitely some of the best advice that I've gotten, because everyone goes through that struggle, like identity.
Oh, yeah.
Like I remember even at some point in college, I was like, wait, like, should I be doing computer science? Like, maybe it's not for me. Like, and I feel like almost everyone has in college specifically has been like, whoa, like, okay. I mean, there's obviously some people who don't, but like a lot of people will go through that thought in their head.
Mm-hmm. Even in grad school, dude.
Yeah, even in grad school, some people will do PhD for like 5 years and be like, wait, this is not it. Like, and like 5 years of PhD down the drain. And actually, one of my coworkers, he's an MD.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he finished medical school. Like, he did some training after, and then he completely transitioned into software. Like, wow. So, and he's literally an MD. Like, he's my coworker, and he's a software engineer. Like, he works in software, right? So. I think like really kind of figuring out like what type of impact you want to have and like, or what you just want out of your life and career is like keeping that big picture always in your head and remembering that, like setting yourself achievable goals is definitely, the best advice.
Yeah. So it's good to be pragmatic. It's good to think about the big picture, and it's good to break it down into granularities in particular. And what I mean by that is like day-to-day steps. How can I achieve this big goal?
For sure.
And then, of course, it's important to do your homework. You know, as good as it may be to eat eggs every single day, if you have the capacity to make a cake, and you go to the grocery store and all you get is eggs, and you have the capacity to get more ingredients, I think it's up to you. You have to make the decision on yourself, you know? Get the ingredients, go through the process, and achieve the end result. So, yeah, of course, there is a degree of serendipity or favor or blessing or whatever you want, may want to describe it as that goes into the journey. But at the end of the day, work is very important. And, you know, yes, we all have our different struggles, and yes, we all have our different challenges that are woven into the narrative of our lives. But I think, you know, depending on how we approach them, and with a good degree of optimism and positivity, I think we could progress through them, hopefully. At least that works out in most cases. So, or we could learn something from it. I think that's more feasible.
Yeah. And I think even like you saying that, like another piece of really good advice that I've gotten, like even related to that, is like, don't get hung up on like setbacks, or like sometimes if you didn't get what you want, like, who knows what's in store for you, man? There's only one person who knows what's in store for you. And I mean, it depends on what you believe in all that, but hey, I personally believe that like everyone has something in store for them.
Yeah.
And like sometimes people will get hung up on like right now, like, oh, this didn't go the way that I wanted to.
Mm-hmm.
Like even relating it back to myself, like I didn't think I'd ever like make the transition back to like my original like desire in terms of like computer science and medicine, right? And like when I first experienced that, like, oh, like I went to freshman year career fair, and I talked to a number of different companies like who are like kind of related to like medicine. And I was like, hey, like, do you guys have openings for computer science majors? And every single one of them said no.
Single
one of them. I went to the pre-health career fair, and every single one of them said no. And like I searched for jobs and all that, and I just really didn't find any. And I was like, man, like maybe this isn't it for me. Like maybe this is just like not it. Like maybe I should like change gears and all that, right? But you know, like 6 years later, here I am now, right now. Like something came, an opportunity came for me, and like I'm back doing what I wanted to do. And so I think like always remembering that, like, you know, everyone has like a destiny, and like there's something, you have ups and downs in your life, but like everything's supposed to happen for a reason too, like, so
yeah. I agree with that, and that comes from my Facebook background, but I agree that everyone's there for a reason. Everyone has intrinsic value, and they can complement the narrative of their own life and other people's lives as well. So yeah, man, but yeah, this is a really good discussion, and it's really good to hear from you, Omar. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for listening. We're glad you were able to tune into this podcast. Once again, this is The New Chemist, where we discuss chemistry, which simply put is the science of change, as well as the other sciences, careers, community, research, and COVID-19. Thanks again for listening. Note, the views on this podcast represent those of my guests and I.